of August 14th, 2013. May we have a roll call, please?
Chairman Manfredi?
Here.
Vice Chair Coates?
Here.
Commissioner Bush?
Here.
Commissioner Cooper?
Here.
Commissioner Kuzner?
Here.
Okay, thanks. Commissioner Coates, would you lead us? Would everyone please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Before we go to public comments, I just want to announce that assuming the meeting goes long, I have to leave at 7 o'clock, no matter what. So with that, we'll go to Section C, which is public comments. Public comments is an opportunity to address the Planning Commission on items of interest to the public that do not appear on the agenda. Comments should be limited to 3 minutes. The Commission may not take action on items raised during public comments. Okay, is there anyone wish to take this opportunity? Okay, we'll go to D. Is there a motion to accept the meeting agenda as written?
Motion to accept.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? I think we had one late correspondence.
Yes, so there's a letter from Matthew Moy regarding item G2 that was just submitted.
Right. I assume everyone got a copy? Mm-hmm. Okay. Now we have the consent calendar. Does anyone want to make any corrections to the minutes as they've been presented? Okay, if there are no corrections to the minutes, they stand approved as read. Next item of business is our first public hearing under Section G. This is the AT&T Foundation Repair Project. That's CUP 2009-03. It's consideration of a conditional use permit request to allow the stabilization of the equipment building by installing helical anchors and constructing a grade beam retaining wall along the south side of the structure located at 1310 Lincoln Avenue. Once the foundation repair and hillside support is complete, the City of Calistoga will install a pathway by generally affixing deciding to the new grade beam. Decking, I'm sorry, to the new grade beam. With that, may we have a staff report, Eric?
Sure. Thank you, Chairman Manfredi, members of the Commission. I would like to make clear what the recommendation is for tonight, which is to adopt a mitigated negative declaration and then to approve a conditional use permit with conditions. The use permit is strictly for the approval of the grading within the stream channel, which would be the grade beam and those anchors that would be affixed into the soil to support the building. This approval is not for the pathway. The pathway would be a subsequent action approved by the City Council upon a negotiated easement with AT&T. The project that you've read in your staff report, I can just summarize real quickly, is to stabilize the bank and add a foundation system for the failing foundation system that is currently at the AT&T building at 1310 Lincoln Avenue. It is an unmanned telecommunication building. It has been there for a number of years. Because of its proximity to the Napa River, it is experiencing some sloughing due to erosion. The intent of the project is to stabilize that, prevent future erosion and failure to the existing structure. We have done an environmental analysis, looked at several different things, including impacts to protected trees and riparian vegetation within the Napa River. There are currently a number of protected trees per the city's ordinance, which is 12 inches in diameter for any tree or any valley oak of any size or any native oak larger than 6 inches in diameter from breast height. We also reviewed trees greater than 3 inches, as that's the California Department of Fish and Wildlife's standard for vegetation removal within their jurisdiction. As a result, we found that there are approximately 12 trees to be removed. We are suggesting mitigation for those removed trees up near the Maxfield Bridge, which if you're all familiar with the Maxfield Bridge, it's a connection between the Riverlea subdivision and the Centennial Circle subdivision. They're experiencing significant failure there. We feel that the mitigation at that site is wise for future protection of that bank. We also took a look at our floodway and conservation regulations. Currently, our floodway regulations really speak to development of structures, physical structures within the floodway, although it does consider these support structures. With that said, though, we feel that there's no impact or result of flood rise as a result of this project, thus no impact. Our conservation regulations speak to setbacks from stream channels. Currently, there's this existing building located within 35 feet of the stream bank. Other than the foundation repairs, there's no suggested change to that building. And provided that the Planning Commission grants this use permit authorizing the construction within the floodway, the AT&T project can move forward. A few other things I'd like to mention are really pertaining to comments that we received from California Department of Fish and Wildlife. They submitted a letter dated July 23rd, 2013. And for the record, we have responded to them as a result of the discussion in the staff report on really three different items, the first being consistency with the general plan. They cited in their letter sections from the county general plan as well as one particular policy from the city's general plan. Although they're true in the fact that the city is encouraging the preservation of the river, we also have several other policies that promote and encourage us to provide opportunities for public access along the Napa River. Ultimately, once this project is completed by AT&T and the city is able to negotiate a lease, we will have that opportunity to install a pathway on this grade beam that's going to be installed by AT&T, thus providing that public access to the Napa River. It will be a short, about 120 feet of pathway, ultimately. If for some reason that project doesn't go through, if we're not able to negotiate the transaction of the property and ultimately the easement, then we're still through this action, this use permit action, helping to protect and stabilize the Napa River. So we've adhered to the general plan policies. The second item was addressing mitigation measures to the protected protected raptor species and trees. We've modified the two mitigation measures that pertain to those, which is mitigation measure bio 3 and 6. You'll find in your staff report those are shown in strike and underline. It's our understanding, and we believe that those changes will address the concerns of Fish and Wildlife when it comes to protected trees and raptor species. And then the third item that California Fish and Wildlife brought up was that there was no discussion of the Swenson hawk in our environmental analysis. Staff conducted a subsequent analysis. We reviewed the habitat conservation plan that was prepared for Solano County Water District. In their report from 2009 prepared by LSA, they found that there's only two nesting sites for the Swenson hawk in Napa County. Those generally occur where there's alfalfa production. So we furthered that research with the help of Lionoccus Phoebe Shu. Put us in contact with a biologist who confirmed that, in fact, this area is really not a good habitat for the Swenson's hawk. They don't like vineyards. They like to open fields. They like to nest in tall trees in areas that are more rural and not urbanized. So we find in this area that the likelihood of the Swenson hawk is nil. This is an urbanized area. There's not a lot of foraging or nesting areas for them. And so we've indicated that in the staff report, as well as informing the California Fish and Wildlife that that there's no potential for impact to this threatened species, the Swenson hawk. So as a result, we are recommending that the Planning Commission adopt a mitigated negative declaration for this project, which includes not only the foundation supports and bank stabilization, but it also is a finding for the pathway. And then secondly, we are suggesting approval of a use permit allowing the construction of a grade beam retaining wall within the stream channel. With that said, if there's any questions on the Planning Commission, I can answer those now. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Eric.
You're welcome.
Do any commissioners have any questions? Please, Commissioner Coates.
Yeah, Eric, just to kind of go back over what we just talked about the concerns by the Department of Fish and Wildlife that have to do with the hawks and the pathway. You've made a determination that you believe that they've been addressed satisfactorily.
Yes.
That being said, this gets approved and goes through, is there going to be something that's another hurdle in front of these folks still, if they, being Fish and Wildlife, disagree? It's just a clarification. I really don't
sure.
know what happens.
There's one protection or hurdle, as you say, that they have to go forward before construction can begin, and that's the nesting surveys that happen prior to construction. If they're within the nesting season, then they'll have to do a survey. And if those surveys find that there, in fact, is the Swenson hawk present, then they'll have to apply through Fish and Game for a take or other mitigation as suggested by their biologist that prepared the nesting surveys. If they're outside the nesting season, then they can proceed forward with the construction of the project. But we feel that this response and the changes to the mitigation measures is adequate for them to move forward with construction.
Okay, you know, I just read the quotes that you have here, and it's kind of like a prolonged exposure, and they kind of go on and on, like there's no end possibly to things that might happen if this project goes forward. So it's a concern. It's not anything that I suspect we can do anything about, but I was more or less trying to get on firm footing with this and try to understand, you know, where they're going with it. And it's kind of vague in some ways. It sometimes leaves the door open for all kinds of things.
Are you talking about the mitigation bio 3 for the surveys?
Line 201, you know, where you have the staff finds that effects are not anticipated, but if you read above, prolonged exposure to deleterious, I guess is the word, debris, increased dispersal of invasive species and things like that. Are those things through the study, I guess, that could be addressed and put to rest satisfactorily? I guess that's my question.
Yeah, those are Fish and Wildlife's comments. They feel that the public intrusion upon this area is going to have an effect. I don't know that they ever visited the site.
Mm-hmm.
I called them and asked them if they wanted to visit the site. They couldn't until the 19th. I informed that the Planning Commission was considering this and let them know that this site is located in the urbanized core of downtown next to Lincoln Avenue, which is heavily traveled highway,
mm-hmm.
next to a parking lot at the fire station, next to an outdoor dining patio at Calistoga Inn. I did not get a response back from them. As a result, it's our position that based on these findings, the proximity, the location, the fact that there's no foraging or nesting habitat, reasonable nesting and foraging habitat, that the presence is very unlikely. Although, to somewhat appease Fish and Wildlife, there still is this mitigation measure for pre-nesting surveys. So if, in fact, there happens to be the random chance that there is a Swenson hawk present during the nesting surveys, they would find that, and then mitigation would be applied at that time to prevent any intrusion upon that particular nest.
Okay, and that's great. I think your finding was correct, and it's just, it's Fish and Wildlife.
Yeah.
So, okay, thank you very much.
Anyone else? Any other commissioners have any questions or comments? Please.
So Eric, get to put this back on. So I have some questions. And looking at that site, you know, it certainly obviously needs that bank repaired. So I don't have a problem with that. But this is more in lieu of understanding ownership here, responsibility. So does that cyclone fence that's currently along the side of the building, does that define the property line as today?
It does not.
What is that?
No, that's just at the top of bank. They're protecting and securing the building.
So beyond that fence, basically goes right up against the edge of the building as it goes down. So it's kind of got this stair-stepped, as you know, kind of shape to the building, and there's that fence that goes along it. So that fence is pretty much on the top of the embankment.
Correct.
But we're talking about putting in a new retaining wall and creating a 5-foot walkway pathway through there, right? Does that mean that, and so my question, continuing that on real quick, and I'll let you get it all. So where is the end of the property line, and where we basically say that the Napa River belongs to whomever, the city?
Well, to begin with, the I guess to answer your question, yes, the fence is at the top of the bank.
Yes.
It does not define the property line.
Okay.
The initial construction will be a grade beam that will sit sort of nestled down into the bank, and that will be supported by these anchors that will be driven back into the bank. That will help support the building and mm-hmm. the bank itself. Ultimately, the pathway would then rest on the grade beam and be affixed onto the building itself. So it wouldn't involve any additional grading outside of what was already done for the initial construction.
But how far out from the building's edge?
It will be about 5 feet.
They're going to, you need to take 5 more feet of that, basically, that
right.
embankment.
Right.
Which
yeah,
I assume belongs to AT&T already.
It currently belongs to AT&T.
So they're basically taking their property and expanding. They're going to put their structures in, secure the hillside, and then leave 5 feet from the edge.
Right. The best exhibit is sheet 5 of okay. the plans. It shows that there isn't much, you know, involved to supporting this building other than the grade beam
right.
and the anchors. And then the city's responsibility then will be seeking funding and then install the decking and the guardrail on the grade beam.
Okay. Having said that, too, I thought I read in some of this great material you provided, by the way, it's very, very thorough, but I thought AT&T was proposing that they would pay for the pathway originally.
No. We worked with them, and most recently we took an item to the city council. It may have been back in October, asking city council direction to move forward. AT&T originally, yes, was going to do that, but then based on their legal counsel came back and said they don't want to take any liability as a result of that based on the public utilities mm-hmm. code. They couldn't. So what will happen is the city council directed us to, yes, we can negotiate a land transfer. We'll take ownership of that land. And
the pathway land.
The pathway land, and then deed back them a use and maintenance easement for the superstructure, the grade beam, and the anchors.
Okay.
So we'll see where that negotiation goes. We haven't started that yet.
Okay. So what was bringing this all to my attention, it seemed to me that with our concern from Fish and Game and all the people that want to control the Napa River, that we're kind of encroaching further out, you know, with permanent structures. I mean, even though they're good ones, you know, I think I agree with the idea, but basically today there's the chain link fence, which is right up against the building, and then it turns into hillside for the drainage for the river. So we're not going to encounter any problems when we take another 5 feet out from the building.
Well, in essence, we're not taking anything out. That's the neat thing about this design. Absent the pathway, the grade beam needs to occur for structural support. Otherwise, there's going to be
right.
you know, some loss of additional land,
mm-hmm.
and the structure could be lost. And actually, this we've talked to AT&T about relocating this service and having some more public interest there.
That came to my mind.
And
another alternative as to why are we even bothering with that building? Just take it out and let them relocate that facility.
Based on their network, it's really infeasible.
All right. So one last question along these lines. So not a question, but a statement. So when we do get to the point where we're going to do a pathway through there, which I think we really need, mm-hmm. and that'll kind of improve that area. But because of the pattern of that building, that kind of sawtooth pattern, I kind of think there's a little bit of a security issue there at night back in there. And I'll be frank, I went back in there today, actually, on both sides. And, you know, and it's right today it's very obvious that there's people back there using it for urination, for clothing, having a few beers maybe. And that we need to seriously think about how we can – I know lighting's a part of the pathway deal, but – what happens is that sawtooth design provides for very convenient kind of hiding places at night that might be out of lights and in the shadows, and you're going to have a lot of visitors just going back to the parking lot. So we might want to think how we can make that area a little bit more secure going forward. But
okay,
that's all I had. Thank you.
Any other commissioners have any questions of staff at this point?
Just a quick question to clarify. So Fish and Wildlife, their only concern is with the pathway then? There's no real contention with the obvious need for repairs?
That was my read of the letter, that yes, the introduction of public there was a concern.
That makes sense.
Okay, this is a public hearing. It's now open. If anyone in the audience would like to address the commission regarding this matter, feel free.
Clarence Levisi, 285 Rosedale Road. First of all, this looks like a win-win situation. Looks neat. I have two or three questions. One, I first saw the identification of the Tree of Heaven, and then I looked deeper and saw that it's supposed to be removed, right? Yeah, I've been seeing that invasive species, and one left alone just becomes awful. The 5 feet for the path, it's also spoken, there's a reference to the bicycle path. Is 5 feet sufficient for both walking and bicycle?
It is not meeting the Caltrans Class 1 standard for a bike path. When we get to that point, we're going to have to design and consider signage, you know, asking bicyclists to get off and walk their bikes.
Okay. Okay. And what Mr. Kushner said at the end of the, maybe that would be a reason to for someone to start thinking about public bathrooms at that end of the town as well, because you know, I've always had a issue with the fact that businesses want everybody's business, but most of them don't want to have to deal with the humanity. And I shared a joke that happened. One of the big archbishops at some point had a church designed, and he looked at these beautiful plans, and he says, "Are we angels?" And they looked at it, and what are you talking about? And he says, "Where are the bathrooms?"
Does anyone else wish to address the commission? Okay, we'll close the public portion and open it up for commission discussion, if any. Do any commissioners have anything they'd like to add?
You know, I only had one small comment. So I saw the hours of construction. I understand why they've limited them from 8 in the morning till 11:30 in the afternoon, you know, because of the businesses around the area that probably wouldn't benefit from construction noise. So I don't know if there's any advantage. It's minor, but 7 o'clock seems to me like it'd be a reasonable time for those guys to get going and get that work done. The more time they have, the quicker hopefully they can get that project done, and less impact on the rest of the town. So that's just one thing to think about.
When did you start work on the inn?
We are pretty at 7 o'clock. I mean, the whole idea was what Commissioner Kushner said, is to get as much done as possible in a limited amount of time and not disturb the surrounding businesses.
Eric, what was the thought behind 8 o'clock?
We received public comments at the city council meeting when the city council directed us to negotiate this lease and land transfer. Based on those public comments from the adjoining uses, Calistoga Inn primarily had some concern with their guests, you know, being disturbed at the early hours, and then the outdoor dining, you know, dust happening as a result of that. We tried to narrow that with input from AT&T as much as we could.
And what was AT&T's input?
They thought that the duration of time was suitable. They've signed off on the mitigated negative declaration, so they've agreed to that stipulation. They also informed us that that construction will be so limited, it's only going to happen for a couple weeks and then they'll be out of there. So based on that, they felt that they could do it.
Okay, any thoughts? Shall we leave it alone or where it is?
I'm good with 8 o'clock.
Yeah, I'm fine with 8 o'clock.
Okay, if AT&T is fine with it, we'll leave it in, and if they...
If we can ask 7 o'clock, I'd like to ask them.
You know, that what can happen, and I don't know how their operation works, but if you said 7 o'clock without a lot of noise, lots of times there's setup time, people moving and getting ready to go, does not disturb the surrounding area, you know, and then at 8 o'clock, when you gear up with whatever equipment you need and make the noise, that does work for me. You know, it's just not disturbing folks that are trying to sleep, and there's a lot of things you can do prior to actually, you know, digging dirt.
Yeah.
Yeah, heavy equipment, because that's the thing that disturbs folks, for loud noises. But there's a lot of assembly time. There's a lot of people getting on, you know, your crew's coming in, setting up, getting ready to go. You know, that takes a half hour on its own, so it will give you an opportunity to do that and maybe expedite the project and make it in a shorter time as well.
Okay, Richard Johnson with AT&T, Senior Project Manager. We can have the 7 o'clock, and we'll use that time from 7 to 8 to get situated and organized.
No. Can we make that subject to any complaints? Not that I really don't anticipate you'd have any, but I think that's reasonable.
As Lynn pointed out, the mitigation really applies to heavy equipment.
I think that covers it. That's really the issue. Yeah.
So you could get in there at 7 to start staging, that kind of thing. It's just the heavy equipment hour.
Okay, so let's be clear.
So while Richard's there, I'll ask you a question. So how much equipment here? And I saw something in the proposal that said we'll have some staging area somewhere, probably back in the parking lot behind the AT&T. Are we going to need to take out any parking spots back there or anything for a while?
Hopefully not. I'm trying to use the two that are kind of back there that we're trying to work and negotiate that those will be kind of identified for AT&T.
Okay.
So that it would eliminate, you know, trying to move AT&T vehicles that park out on the street to back in the back so that you have more parking for your businesses out on Lincoln.
Okay, just, you know, parking gets to be an issue in this town, and you know, when we have a project like that going on, we could, I don't know how much equipment you're going to have. Sounds like you've got a pretty minimal amount of equipment that will be going in there.
It's going to have to be fairly small because there isn't much room.
I know, right? Okay, thanks.
Okay, so what have we decided? Have we decided?
Doesn't need to change.
It doesn't need to change.
Yeah. This is just stipulating when the heavy equipment can operate.
Yeah, and I think there's, in the proposal, there's an alternative. I think, as I recall, it said that it could be, different hours could be approved with basically the permission of
the department.
Office. Yeah, so that if there's points in time where they really do need to get in there and get set up a little earlier, I'm sure that
exactly. You
guys can use reasonableness on that.
Right. Okay, is there anyone else wish to address the commission on this item since we reopened it? Oh, okay, is there any other comments from commissioners? Well then, Commissioner Bush, would you like to make motion A?
I move that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution adopting a mitigated negative declaration, finding that with the inclusion of mitigation measures, the project will not have a significant adverse impact on the environment.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Commissioner Coach, would you like to make B?
I move the Planning Commission adopt a resolution approving a conditional use permit application allowing the stabilization of the equipment building by installing. Anchors and constructing a grade beam retaining the wall along the south side of the structure located at 1310 Lincoln Avenue.
I second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay. Well, good luck.
Yeah, thank you for fixing that wall.
Okay, we will now go to our second public hearing. This is a zoning code amendment, ZO-2013. Excuse me. It's a consideration of a recommendation to the Calistoga City Council on a text amendment to the Calistoga Municipal Code. This amendment was initiated by the City of Calistoga and would add protection for farmers who use accepted and standard farming practices against nuisance suits, even if the farming practices harm or bother adjacent property owners or the general public. The ordinance would also require disclosure about the potential inconveniences and discomforts associated with agricultural operations. So with that, Eric?
Actually, Lynn's going to present the item.
I made a note to say that. And I didn't say it anyway.
Thank you. The open space and conservation element of the Calistoga General Plan calls for the city to adopt a right to farm ordinance that advises purchasers and users of property near agricultural operations of the inherent potential problems associated with those operations, and to prevent existing farms operating according to accepted agricultural practices from being unfairly judged to be a public nuisance or unacceptable use. And the ordinance you see before you, the draft ordinance, addresses those two provisions. We have fleshed out who this information would have to be disclosed to besides upon the transfer of property. It would also include owners of rental property would have to disclose to tenants when they're renting out or leasing out property. Also, visitor accommodations operations and the applicant for a building permit for the construction of a residence or a commercial building within the city limits. These provisions are similar to that adopted by Napa County. Also, the state has adopted the California Agricultural Protection Act, which it is very similar to, and these types of regulations have been adopted throughout the state and actually throughout the country. The city did sponsor a community meeting to solicit input on a previous draft, and several of the comments that we received at that meeting are incorporated into the final draft. And we also received some comments that we decided not to incorporate, and those are the reasons for that were explained in the written staff report. The Napa Valley Grape Growers has submitted a letter in support of the proposed ordinance. And staff is recommending that the commission recommend to the city council approval of this amendment that would add a chapter to the municipal code called right to farm. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay.
And as I'm sorry, as you noted, you've received also a letter from Matthew Moy tonight.
Yes. Do any commissioners have any questions at this time of staff or comments on the staff report?
So, Lynn, you said this is similar to Napa County ordinance that's already exist, right?
In concept.
In concept?
Yeah, not to the letter.
So do we have do we have any issues about whose takes priority, or, you know, do we have any issues of conflict where theirs is more encompassing or less? And what I'm getting to is if one's better than the other, if we couldn't mm-hmm. determine that Napa County had one.
No, they're essentially the same in that regard. It's basically preventing the city from finding agricultural operations to be a nuisance. It's not, we can't regulate, you know, activities that are in the county or anything like that. So it's simply to provide disclosure and to prohibit the city from finding that an agricultural operation is a nuisance. So that wouldn't really affect one way or the other.
I was just trying to eliminate redundancy if there was any. I mean, like, all we have to do is refer to...
No, the county's regulations would apply to county properties. You know, the county won't find that an agricultural operation, whether it's in the county or city, yeah. is a nuisance and vice versa. So they just, you know, coexist.
So having bought some property here several years ago now, I did sign a document similar to that. For property, residential property in Calistoga?
Yes.
So what is the difference from what I signed then and what we're proposing now?
Well, as it turns out, we discovered that the realtors are already having people sign that kind of disclosure and acknowledgement. We think because, you know, it's pervasive throughout the county, it's just easier to throw it in there and have somebody acknowledge it. So this language will be a little bit different from what they're using right now. But, yeah, it was kind of funny to find out that, people are already signing this kind of acknowledgement when they buy a piece of property.
So if we go through with it, how are we going to implement this? Are we going to go to the title companies throughout the county and say, here's our form?
Right,
this
and the realtors.
Needs to be in your, mm-hmm. you know, and the brokers and so forth?
Right, yeah, they're very familiar with it, as you just mentioned. Yeah, yeah, so yeah. It'll just be, this is the city's language, so for any properties within the city limits.
Another document in your closing.
Oh, yeah, no, that's, you know, it's just one of the 42 that you have to
initial. Yeah, already assigned, right, that you don't understand anyway.
Right.
All right, thank you.
I had a quick question. Is this meant to mitigate potential lawsuits from members of the community or specifically the city?
It's not really meant to mitigate lawsuits. It's just to prohibit the city from finding anything as a nuisance. Okay. We don't really get involved in the lawsuit aspect of it.
Okay, and historically...
But they could. But somebody bringing a lawsuit or defending against a lawsuit actually could cite this ordinance as, you know, the basis for not declaring something a nuisance.
And historically, historically, has it been a, I mean, how
actually,
often?
Actually, no. We've never had a problem. So,
it's
heading off any potential problems. You know, as we add more people and more development and, you know, higher end resorts, that kind of thing.
Okay, good.
Any comments? I just have one comment, Lynn, on Exhibit A on line 50. Smoke is highlighted. So my understanding is, I talked with Eric this morning, whether you're a farmer or not, you still need to get a burn permit. Right.
Yes, you'll still have to get a burn permit. This is simply advising, you know, there could be smoke associated with agriculture operations.
No, I just wanted to clarify to everyone that this doesn't mean...
No, it doesn't exempt them from the need to get a burn permit.
They need a permit.
Exactly. No, it would not exempt any operation from having to get routine permits. Right.
Okay. And my other comment I mentioned to Eric also... This is not covered in this, but it may be. A couple of people asked me. This doesn't mention at all beekeeping.
Right.
And they wanted to know: Would beekeeping be considered farming?
It could be considered. It definitely could be considered an agricultural operation.
I mentioned to Eric maybe it would behoove the city, at when there's time to give. Give bees a chance. Think that's funny?
Oh.
So do I, do. But it's on the cover of Time magazine. Bees. You know, I mean, they're very, very important. I mean, I don't have to tell you guys. So anyway, it's completely omitted, and you can be sure someone's going to.
We do allow animal keeping in under certain circumstances, on certain properties in certain districts. So that would be interpreted as... You know, you can also do like light agricultural operations. That would be included in the light agricultural operation.
Okay, with that, the public hearing is open. I saw you with a net on the other net. So anyone feel free to address the commission.
Dennis McNay, 2653 Foothill Boulevard. My thought on this was... how does this affect new vineyards? Because I may want to buy Highland Court subdivision and plow it up and plant grapes next door to me. And if I do that, I'd have to have a use permit, I'm sure, but how is it going to affect this ordinance? Because I noticed this sample ordinance you had in the back here from San Luis Obispo, it said existing vineyards from 1993. So I was just wondering what the effect was going to be if there was to be a new vineyard.
I don't think, from reading this, there would be any impact, but because it doesn't clarify. It doesn't say.
People that are living next door to that property when I convert it to a vineyard, you know.
Well, of course, you would have to, anyone, not just you, you would have to get a use permit.
Right. Understand.
So it's not a vineyard until it's a vineyard. Not a vineyard, just because.
Exactly,
you think it's
but I just wondered if that, you know, there was predating in
yes,
here.
Please,
said.
Lynn.
This doesn't address the establishment of a new vineyard. It simply says that you can't declare something a nuisance if it's been in operation for more than 3 years, if it hasn't been declared a nuisance during that time. So if you were to establish a vineyard and year two, for some reason, the city determined it was to be a nuisance, you know, we could. Follow that, but once it's been in operation for 3 years, it basically says we can't determine it to be a nuisance. As long as it's being operated in accordance with, you know, accepted agricultural practices.
That was my question. Thank you.
Sure.
Yeah, so that was kind of following that, sorry. I think that's the key because it's the three-year thing. You can't be in violation to start, but the question I had was, Lynn, for... which Dennis might be interested in, is as long as you're using established farming practices, which is a nice, clear statement. But the problem I had, the note I made, well, who determines that? I mean, you could get into a big argument about
if Dennis is having a vineyard and he decides he's going to use a process of some way that somebody finds detrimental?
That comment actually came up during the public little community meeting we had.
Uh-huh.
And as I mentioned in the staff report, we may be seeking the advice of the County Agricultural Commissioner if we need technical advice in this area.
Okay.
So
that's fair enough.
We don't really have a lot of experience ourselves, but it was suggested that he or she could be the referee, but we don't really want to get into that. It's just simply, you know, they may be able to assist us in determining whether it's being conducted in accordance with accepted practices.
Yeah. And I think, you know, like a lot of things, practices are always changing.
Yep, absolutely.
So I think that's where we probably get into some agricultural experts that say, you know, that's a new process that...
Well, that's one of the reasons I was reluctant to include a lot of detail about, you know, smudge
specific,
pots
and
you know, things, you know, practice, as you mentioned, practices come and go and new ones come up, like wind machines or whatever. And so I left it purposely broad to just try and encompass accepted practices without going into great detail and try to, you know, cover everything that might come down the line.
Yes. I saw that. I agree.
Well, in light of that, maybe it would be good to add in that statement that these practices evolve, they do change, which would then, you know, like Matt Moy's point is well taken with the nighttime harvesting, which is becoming, you know, more prevalent for all sorts of reasons. It doesn't have to be listed, but if the clarifier is that these practices evolve with farming, they do change.
It just simply refers to a manner consistent with proper and accepted customs and standards as established and followed by similar agricultural operations in the same locality. So I think that would encompass anything at any point in time.
So in light of that, I appreciate Matt Moy's suggestions, but I don't think they have to be, because then, as Eric pointed out to me, the danger is if you list so many things, and then it's like you're approving something that's not listed, or you're denying, and it can just get
that often happens. People
crazy.
Will point to a list and say, well, there's no, you know, wind machines, or there's no nighttime harvesting listed in here, and like, well, you know, no, but, you know, it's an accepted practice.
So. It is a false.
Yeah, I appreciate that. He highlighted two things that he thought might be most disturbing to resort guests, you know, the most noise, the most light, that kind of thing. And I appreciate that, but it's just back to the concept of trying to, you know, we get into it a little more in the disclosure statement. You know, we get into insects and fumes and smoke, and so we're trying to highlight what those bad things might be. Well, not bad, just perceived to be negative by somebody who's paying $800 a night for a hotel room.
Is there anyone else wish to address the commission?
Jim Barnes, 1710 Michael Way, Calistoga. On this issue you've just been discussing, the insurance industry, of which I was a member of for 33 years, underwent years and years and years of analysis of how to write a policy to address what was covered and what was not covered. And it finally came down to a standard industry wording of all risks of direct physical loss or damage excluding. Excluded what they didn't want to cover, everything else was covered. So if you could use a wording something like that, it would probably solve the problem you're talking about.
Thank you. Thanks for your comment. Clarence, I saw you pop up.
Clarence Levisi, 285 Rosedale Road. On the night we had the discussion, there were a number of ideas that were brought out, and many of those are included. This is without doubt an excellent document that Lynn and Aaron Eric have put together. There is one issue, however, I would disagree with, and that's the idea that the city is not involved, and that all this does is protect the city from making a declaration of an activity being a nuisance. The whole point is that the neighbor is the one who will declare it. Let's be real. the neighbor's going to come to the city and complain. So now what happens? What happens? The city is involved. Now, is the city going to say, oh, well, we're not going to do anything? We're not going to help? We're not going to facilitate? We're not going to do anything? And then what happens? The person gets upset, talks about it, who knows what they're going to do, and then a lawsuit between parties is started. And then you have clashing. This isn't good for any industry. This isn't good for our industry. And on one or two of the discussion meetings we've had, this came up as an activity that has been faced at the county level on more than one issue, more than one circumstances. And one of the things we talked about that night, and we didn't nail down to any specific way of approaching, was that when someone comes to the city and complains about a farming operation, there needs to be some reasonable way to facilitate, because this is the way communication works, facilitate the person complaining with the person whose activities are being complained about. What that complaint is, the complaint and the activities, and then starting the process of facilitating communication between those people. And Peter Nesson, sharing some examples of the county, pointed out that this is how they resolved two or three of the issues that have come up. And that night we said, well, you know what, it seems to me the city, the Chamber of Commerce, as well as the city, has a hell of a lot of vested interest in not letting something that's a complaint escalate into lawsuits for any reason. And that's why with that night we discussed the idea of whether someone at the city council, in the city offices would act as some kind of facilitator, whether they would discuss it, it could be discussed with the Chamber of Commerce, if they would act as a facilitator, if the city would take the complaint because it was about agriculture and talk to the Agricultural Commission. We didn't say what was best, we're not exactly sure. We left that, there were different ideas that were given by different people, but the point that all of us agreed upon is that we wanted some kind of facilitating that, since the complaint is going to obviously be initiated into the city at City Hall, there should be some initiation of a process that would facilitate communication so that it would not escalate, it could be worked out. One of the interesting things that happened that night that I thought was it was interesting, because I really hadn't thought that much about it in terms of city farming, was three or four of the farmers talked about the different activities. And then there was a discussion, well, yeah, but this has bothered this person, that has bothered somebody else we heard about, but we talked to him, et cetera. But the thing that had been brought up a number of times was, wait a minute, the farmer is not working on the 9-to-5 schedule. The farmer, the grape person, doesn't matter what kind of farming you're talking about, gardening, olive orchards, grapes, they all work on one thing, nature. We're paying attention to nature's thing. How hot it is it? How dry is it? When's it frosting? When's the wind blowing to spray and not spray? And so a lot of that work is not done 9-to-5, we'll start on Monday. It's done according to nature and what the weather is. And I'm not sure where, but in our educational process, we obviously have to get this particular issue communicated more, because I think it seems like when you hear a complaint, it's usually, and they're legitimate complaints, but it's also, there's also an aspect of them that is not realizing that, well, yeah, but there's no wind. That's why I have to be out there spraying at that time. Because if there's wind, then it's going to get to the neighbors. And good farming practices is you do not spray during wind. because you want it to stay right where it's at. So it doesn't bother anybody. It does right where it's on the vineyard. A side issue, if you might take a note for future discussions at somewhere. This morning, for about the fourth time, I've had walkers or joggers up our dirt roads, going from the bike path or from one end of the valley to the other because they have see the dirt road. There's an interesting, we have an interesting conflict here. And there's truths and values on both sides. And I'm not sure what the answer is. But I would like, hopefully, that you won't just hear me and walk on, but you'll really share some discussions and remember this. Is, in reality, joggers and bikers and especially joggers and walking people, it's much better for your feet to walk on the dirt than it is to the cement or the asphalt. So, you know, when they're telling them, well, walk down all the roads on the edges, is not, I mean, yeah, that's the option, the only option other than liability on our farm, but it's also not the best that's for them. But at the same time, we don't have any indication of how signs about spraying or anything. So somehow, this there's a problem there that we're going to keep facing, and I don't know what the resolution of it is. But I think walkers have some rights and are excellent for this town. But I also think we have to deal with the liabilities, and I'm not sure what the answer is. I hope you'll think about it.
Thank you. Thanks for your comments, Mr. Levisi. Is there anyone else wish to address the commission on this item?
Norma Toffanelli, 1001 Dunnewheel Lane, also speaking with you tonight for Napa County Farm Bureau. And we are very encouraged to see and commend the city for moving this forward. It's very encouraging to see the statement, your policy statement, that the city of Calistoga, which our cities focus on urban issues, however, do recognize that it is important to preserve, protect, and encourage the use of agricultural lands within the city limits. Your new billboard on the entrance to town shows cyclists in vineyards. So it's nice to know we have a growing partnership with the city in recognizing the importance of agriculture to the city of Calistoga and the importance of the agriculture within your city limits to the city of Calistoga. I think Clarence brought up a good point about communication, and Farm Bureau went through this, and I believe the growers were involved also, and Dave Whitmer, our Ag Commissioner, when we did have some issues in Napa on nuisance complaints. And we would encourage you, as the stakeholders requested, if a complaint does come forward, many times it's the communication about the complaint that resolves it rather than anything having to be escalate and get to a more serious stage. And I would say that city staff is not knowledgeable and is not expected to be and is not bound to be knowledgeable about what is good agricultural practices. So we would encourage you to include a process that would include, say, the Ag Commissioner or a representative from Farm Bureau, someone in the Ag community that could perhaps mediate if a complaint does occur. Because it came up at the stakeholders meeting, someone asked why his neighbor was spraying at this ungodly hour and why so often. Well, he had no knowledge, and I don't know if staff has knowledge of, they wouldn't have any reason to, that every grape grower in this county is under mandate. We cannot sell our grapes unless we meet the county spray requirement for the European grapevine moth. And believe me, we found out. We had some issues because of the way we spray. It was very hot. We didn't want to burn the shoots. I got an email from the Ag Commissioner's office. Where's your spray report? We told you to spray last week. You didn't spray. So we are bound by some of those issues. And I wouldn't think the city would be in a position to really understand those. But if you had a partner in the Ag Commissioner's office or a partner from Farm Bureau, might help you resolve those without having them escalate. So this is very encouraging. I think Clarence brings up many good points. I hope the city continues a dialogue with your farmers. I hope you recognize your farmers are a valid point. You are, you know, a resort town, always have been. But the farms have supported this town and continue to support. And as Farm Bureau just celebrated our centennial and honored our centennial farming families, those farming families who have been farming for over 100 years in Napa County, many of them are within your city limits. So we appreciate that you're moving this forward. And I do extend to you from Napa County Farm Bureau, if we can aid in the process in any way, if there were any questions as complaints came up, we would be very happy to extend whatever assistance we could. Thank you.
Thank you for your comment. Anyone else wish to address the commission? Okay, so, we will close the public portion.
Good. Can I ask a question of staff on this issue now?
Yeah, let me just close the public portion, and then we'll, yeah. Okay, and if necessary, we will reopen it. So now, Walter?
This is for staff. So I think Clarence kind of jogs my, raises some concerns, which I think might be legitimate, but by the city incorporating these kinds of statutes in their public code, are we at risk at all of becoming party to these nuisance suits? In the sense I'm saying that, you know, if we enact legislation here in the city that more or less protects people that might be perceived to have involved in nuisance activities, it's not going to stop lawsuits from being filed. It's a way that we hope that we can say, well, you know, go ahead and file one, but here's the city's statutes, and you're probably not going to win, so common sense says don't do this. But if they proceed, they could perceive that the city of Calistoga, it could become a joint agent in this process, and we could be party to some additional lawsuits. Is that something we need to bring up to our own attorneys to say that do we possibly incur any liabilities if we institute such statutes?
I am not an attorney. I don't believe so. I don't think it would be any different than us being liable to be named in a lawsuit for any type of action that's filed. Whether it be for a hotel development or anything like that. So we will, you know, go through the process. We'll call upon the resources of the Agricultural Commissioner, the Farm Bureau, whoever we feel is, you know, can advise us and who is knowledgeable, and depend on, you know, their advice and do our own investigation. So to the extent possible, you know, we'll cover the city's potential liability. You know, as we mentioned, we don't know about any nuisances ever been, you know, ever having been requested, you know, that determination ever having been requested of the city.
Well,
don't anticipate
about,
though, an avalanche.
If I have a little vineyard over here, of an acre vineyard, and it's not going to do much good to sue me because you're not going to get much out of it.
Right.
But if I perceive that, that the city has some kind of involvement in the sense that they more or less supported this nuisance activity, or this what you perceive to be, it's pretty well known that most people kind of figure out where the deep pockets are and make sure if they're going to file a lawsuit, they go to the place where there's the most money. So that, in this case, wouldn't be me, it would be the city. So I just, a little bit moderately concerned. I know it hasn't happened, but when people see a chance to make some money, things change.
All I can say is we would do our best to, you know, demonstrate that our decision to declare it a nuisance or not would be based on the best available information.
Okay, and then my very last comment, I promise. On looking at this, we're talking about the draft ordinance here, and it says talks about visitor accommodations operations. And it says that we'll must display an informational card in the guest rooms, and in a conspicuous public location. My note on that was, that if you're going to put it in the guest room, it's probably a little too late. So we need to. People who come, you know, they want to know about these things before they check in. Okay, it's not after they're in the room. So I would try to move that up a little bit and make it more visible at the time the accommodation is accepted.
Right. That would be really hard for the city to monitor. It's going to be We're going to have to add this to our checklist of things to monitor, but...
Something's at the sign-up desk.
You know, we could definitely urge the visitor accommodations owners to do so.
Yeah, I'd work through the Chamber of Commerce and say this is an issue, and maybe we can put a... I know there's a lot of signs on the desk when you sign in a lot of places, but...
Right, something
that lets them know at the beginning, not the end. That's it. Sorry. Thank you.
No. Any other comments?
Yeah, I think... No, this is just my opinion, obviously. You know, this is disclosure. It's just informing people who we are. I mean, I don't know where all this litigation... I'm sorry, Commissioner Kuzner. I don't know. Lawsuits, that's a civil matter. If something's happened, it's not the city's responsibility. I think the city's doing the right thing, stepping up and working with the Farm Bureau to inform the folks that come here, the folks that move here, that this is who we are. Excuse me. We coexist. If it wasn't for the wine industry, the cities would not thrive. If it wasn't for the tourists coming here, it wouldn't spread the word about how wonderful we have a valley that has some of the best wine in the world. So that being said, this is simply a disclosure. I think we're overthinking this a little bit. I do like Norma's suggestion of, in some way, if there are complaints or concerns, that they get sent to the Farm Bureau because they are the experts. Those are the folks that can, I guess, set people's mind at ease if there is an impact that they perceive that's negative to them. So this being said, they don't want to go beyond what we're being requested of tonight, and it's simply a disclosure. We're telling folks, here's who we are, here's what we do, be aware of it. You can love it or you can leave it, I guess. That's really where we're at. This is who we are. So I just don't want to overthink it, that's all.
Commissioner Bush?
Yeah, I absolutely agree with what Commissioner Coates just said. My only suggestion would be when you're doing, and I don't know whether you're just going to copy what Napa County does, when you inform people, either the guests at the lodging industry or people that are buying, that you write it in English and not in excessive legalese, so it's kind of clear what you're trying to say. I think it's such a great asset to Calistoga that within 10 minutes you can walk from downtown and be surrounded by vineyards and hopefully not trespass. I think that's just a tremendous asset for Calistoga, and I don't think you find that anyplace else in the Napa Valley.
Thank you. Commissioner Cooper, you have anything to add?
No.
I don't have any further comment. So, remember, we're making recommendations. It's not a hard and fast rule. So, Commissioner Kuzner, would you please make a motion?
Certainly. So this is the motion. I move the Planning Commission adopt a resolution recommending to the City Council approval of an amendment to the Calistoga Municipal Code adding protection for farmers from nuisance suits and requiring disclosure about agricultural operations.
Is there a second?
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Okay, that was a good report. Okay, with that, we come to, if any commissioners have anything they'd like to put on the table. Eric, I have a few questions. One, I just... is there any progress with the Auden Winery? Anything happening?
We have a building permit for the winery building ready to be issued. They're waiting funding, and then they've informed us that they're moving forward in preparing plans for the hospitality building.
And also, any status update on Silver Rose?
I don't have any information on Silver Rose. Okay. All we know is, again, they're waiting on funding.
I just ask you what people ask me, and I
sure.
So, okay.
Yeah, they've met their obligation under the development agreement to submit their funding of $2 million. That's been a good asset for the community so far. Now we're just anticipating construction documents.
Quick question. That Enchanted Forest, did they meet their deadline?
They did. We received $1.2 million from Enchanted Forest.
Okay. Is there a director's report?
I would just like to let you know that the City Council is going to consider authorizing the Green Committee to proceed with a voluntary program to voluntarily discontinue the use of plastic carryout bags at next Tuesday's meeting. Doesn't really affect the commission, except for the fact we're trying to avoid having to adopt an ordinance, which would ultimately come through you for a recommendation. So the Green Committee is requesting that they be allowed to approach the various merchants and say, hey, will you voluntarily comply and, you know, promote the use of reusable bags instead of single-use carry-out bags.
And what, do you know what our next agenda will be?
Sure. We've got Pioneer Park on there. We have a freestanding ATM that's requested. That would involve a zoning ordinance amendment to allow freestanding ATMs and a conditional use permit to actually approve this specific ATM. And one more thing. Oh, yeah, the conversion of a single-family dwelling to an office use on Lower Washington.
Okay, with that, is there a motion to adjourn? A second? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
And you're out of here before 7.
Yes. Good.